Vive, beyond ViveX. So I'm not going to introduce them all individually, but if everyone here from the Vive team could raise their hand. Okay, so if you, mainly by the bar, you'll notice. So feel free to go and grab those guys later if you've got any other Vive-related questions. So quick poll of the audience, an easy one to start with. Who owns a Vive? Who owns a Vive Focus? Okay, that's a decent amount as well. So Graham over there is holding up a Vive Focus. If anyone's interested, this is the awesome new six-stop standalone headset that has been out there in Asia. And we're interested, not just startups, but any developers and content creators should really check out the device because it is going to be a game changer. Okay, slightly harder question. Who here either has or wants to start their own company? And how many have either applied for ViveX or are thinking of applying for ViveX in batch 4? Alright, okay, we have the right audience in the room. Everyone else can just go and play Beat Saber at the end and okay, so hopefully my job is going to be fairly easy tonight and just tell you stuff that you hopefully already know. But just to clarify a bit more about our approach to ViveX and what it means for us here in Europe. So ViveX was launched 2016, I think April 2016, is a $100 million fund or a $100 million global VR and AR accelerator. And it's not just about investing money, although ultimately we are investing money into your business, receiving some equity, and because of that, we want you to be the next billion-dollar companies in Europe, and I think that's very possible. In my mind, there should be, in the next 3 or 4 years, there should be at least $5 billion companies that come out of the immersive computing space. So I want to be able to invest in those guys. It's not just about the money, it's also helping to foster and cultivate the entire immersive computing ecosystem. So that's not just VR, that's AR, and I'll talk a bit more about Vive Reality and where we see some of the other technologies converging later on. And because of our commitment to growing the ecosystem, it means we've actually become the world's most active investor in AR and VR startups. So over 80 to date. A lot of them are awesome. A lot of them have gone on to raise a lot of money. Hopefully you guys will add to that number. So you probably know ViveX is being active in 5 different cities. It is a city-driven program, but it's really about covering regions and just being accessible to startups and innovation wherever it happens in the globe. So San Francisco, Shenzhen, Taipei, Beijing, more recently Tel Aviv. And obviously for you guys, the great news is that last month we added London to the mix. I think what's really important to say is ViveX London, you know, we're here, we have a base here, we're in the Huckletree space today. We have our HQ in a beautiful sunny Slough, but it's not just about the UK and London. This ViveX London is really acting as a hub for innovation and startups across Europe. So probably most of you, just raise a hand, did anyone fly in for the event today? Okay, right, I like the dedication, that's awesome. So thanks for coming and to learn more about ViveX. We are going to be doing some other events in Berlin, Amsterdam, Madrid, and somewhere else that I can't forget, there's too many events. But if you're in one of those locations, please spread the word to other founders. I find the best source of referrals is from you guys. It's from people who are on the ground making content and making businesses. Okay, so one of the biggest questions that I get asked is, what are we looking for ViveX? It can be confusing, you know, it's an accelerator, what's a startup, like, do I count? Well, we've invested in many different sectors to date, ranging from consumer applications to AI stuff to, I was at the San Francisco Demo Day, and we had 2 companies doing brain-computer interfaces. So, you know, we are really investing in the entire ecosystem. But for Europe, what we expect to find is some really great talent in the B2B and enterprise space. We're not ruling out anything else. Again, you know, think about Paul's background at Spotify, some of the big billion-dollar companies that have come out of Europe have been in fashion or in music. But really, for us, this is about key areas, and I think Vive at the moment is really leading the pack when it comes to B2B enterprise with devices like the Vive Pro and soon to come on the market, the Vive Focus. So if you're doing something in healthcare, if you're doing something in training, productivity, or even things that we probably don't even yet know, then we really want to hear from not just about sectors. You know, a big thing for us is you know, this vision of Vive reality, and this is the convergence of several different like big technology shifts that we're seeing happen. So not just VR, there's AR very much a part of our roadmap at the moment. But also if you think about the future, you know, all of these technologies are being hugely affected by companies applying AI. We're actually thinking forward to the future 5G networks that we're going to see coming to the UK and many other countries very, very soon. All right, okay, so maybe I don't get this asked so much, but what are we not looking for? I think it's really interesting to be precise. We don't want to waste your time. We do want to connect with you guys, but not all of you are going to be suitable for ViveX. So things that we aren't looking for is individual content creators, like individual projects. We do have other vehicles for, you know, a couple of years ago, we had VR for Impact, for example. We have Vive Studios, where we're doing a lot to help fund studios and second and third party content. So if you're not sure whether you fit into the bracket, it's a bit of a gray area. Feel free to come and find me or email me or get in touch and I can help clarify. One thing I would say, if you're not sure and you're thinking of applying, I would say go ahead and apply. Actually, the exercise of just going through 30 minutes and putting your business plan down on paper is a very helpful exercise, whether it's leads to an investment or not. So I'll put up the application form later on, but I would definitely encourage you to do that. Okay, another question I get, what stage do you invest in? So, well, 2 years ago when we set up, there wasn't actually that many VR companies. So, you know, if you said that you're an experienced or mature VR founder, you were probably either making it up or you were in the first crew 20 years ago building their caves and kind of innovating in the first wave. So 2 years ago, we were investing very early in people who were just putting their product out to market. I think if you fast forward 2 years, there's a lot of talent, there's a lot of mature ideas in companies. So there's no hard and fast rule, but typically you're going to have a product that's out in the market. You might have your first couple of customers, and you're really thinking about how to kind of land and expand in one specific key customer segment. You know, lots of things around that, again, like feel free to ask me, but it's, you know, think about, can Vive really add value in that first 6 months of the business? And if you're still building the prototype, the answer to that is probably no. So we're playing in the early stages. Probably pre-Series A. We do have two other vehicles that many of you might know about. So there is the VRVCA. This isn't Vive investing directly, but it is us really helping to bring deal flow to venture capitalists who are qualified and really want to invest in the sector. So we have a huge amount of funds from the guys who are in their alliance, and that might be something for you if you feel you're past ViveX. And then this is something that was announced recently in China. We also have our Premier Fund, which is a partnership with the government in Shenzhen. This is really only for companies that are serious about the Asian market and have a presence out there. So probably not relevant to many of you in the audience, but thought I'd mention it. And again, if it is of interest, then do come and talk to us. Okay, so I've talked a lot about money. ViveX really isn't just about money. It is about the value add that we can provide to you guys. So if you're thinking, right, I'm just going to get a check and go away and build my business, probably not for you. But a lot of people ask, where does that value add come from? And it's really many different areas, almost too many to speak to. It's everything from our network or our support or connecting you to different organizations. We don't run a formal mentorship program, but we have a very broad network spanning Europe, Asia, and America. So there's probably, if there's someone that's important to your business, very likely that we know them and we've been out for a drink with them the night before. There is a formal program. It's been extended from 4 months to 6 months, just so we can make sure that we really work with you over a slightly longer time span. It doesn't just end in 6 months. You know, once you're part of the ViveX family, you know, like we want to see you through to IPO. We have a vested interest in doing so. But that first 6 months is really an intensive period where we can help shape your business. And it's kind of, you know, the critical phase that's going to determine your success. Like I said, we don't have a formal mentorship program, but we do have a lot of people and a lot of goodwill out there of people who want to help companies come into the market. And I should mention fundraising. You know, we're investing like low six-figure numbers into your business, so in the next 6 to 18 months, you're probably going to want to go out and raise a larger round, probably from institutional capital. And the good news is that we have the best network of people who want to invest in these sectors. Mentioned a couple of other things. Paul already mentioned it. Viveport, you know, is a growing a place where you can go and get a lot of different content and applications. We have a lot of resources internally, and we also have a lot of functional expertise. So whether it's, you know, Alia with her PR expertise, or whether it's someone in Shenzhen with a little product and hardware expertise, you know, we have those people internally, and we can be your kind of flashlight to guide you to those key people. So just to call it out again, you know, I think Viveport is a very important part of that mix. Vive Studios, which I've already mentioned, which is really our vehicle for funding first, second, and third party content. But this is really important, and a lot of people forget this. Your closest allies are going to be the founders that have gone before you. Because we've invested in 80 companies, that's well over 100, 120 founders who have had to struggle through hiring, fundraising, finding that key contact at the important business. So this is a network that is now active and is one that ViveX companies can readily tap into. All right, so hopefully that's got some of you in the audience thinking, yes, I am going to go home tonight after five beers and do the application. If it's not, if you're not going to do it tonight, you need to apply by 30th of June. Try and do it a bit before, but 30th of June is the kind of outright deadline. I would say about the application process, we do receive a lot of applications. You know, this is like, you know, the percentage of people that get into ViveX is, you know, no single digit. So it's harder to get into ViveX than it is into an Ivy League school. But I would say the application isn't going to get you through on its own. Try and find a warm introduction either into myself, you're doing a good start because I'm here, or into one of the other ViveX team members globally. We will be hopefully formalising the selection investments over the summer, and then in September we will kick off with you know, a number, you know, 3 to 5 really great investments that we're ready to help get on the road. Cool. So if anyone's into QR codes, I don't think I've scanned. No, actually, I scanned the QR code this morning to log into WeChat. But if you're into QR codes, there's the link, or go to vivex.com. Deadline again is 30th of June. I will be around. I won't take questions now because I want to crack on with the panel, but I will be taking questions later on, or we can do some of them over email or offline. My email, I don't have a slide on it, but it's dave_haynes@htc.com.
Got it.
Cool. All right. Good stuff. And just, I want to have a big round of applause for two people tonight. First of all, Kieran at Huckletree. Where's Kieran? Oh, he's gone. Oh, okay, I'll tell him we all cheer. And also for Thomas Gear at Reality Centre. You know, Reality Centre, we're here in this space when it launched. I've been to some other great events here. And I think it's, you know, like ViveX, it really takes people like Thomas, you know, to prime this ecosystem and help connect a lot of people. So maybe a massive round of applause for Thomas. Prepare this panel, so let's see where it goes. But really the goal is to, these are guys that have either gone through the financing process or people who have actually invested in the sector like that. So just to kick us off, maybe you guys could just give a short introduction, what you do, who you are, and what your relevance is to this company is. Let's start with Matt.
Sure. My name's Matt. I work for a venture capital firm called Forward Partners. We're a very, very early stage fund, so we invest in Series A with a slightly different model than most venture capital firms who just provide the money and strategic advice. We've got a large team, significantly large investment team of operators who help businesses that we invest in make incremental gains every single day. You know, that's super important, and we work very, very closely with the pre-seed companies and then on some slightly more in-depth work with the seed stage companies and across the portfolio. So, we do work with the later stage businesses too. In fact, there's someone from Forward Partners here in the audience, which I didn't know ahead of time. But no, I suppose the reason why I'm here is that Dave, probably about this time last year actually, introduced a company called Gravity Sketch to me, and we completed an investment into that company later on, so I think Q3 in that year. So I'm invested in the space and obviously interested. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Could you guys hear that in the back, by the way?
I'm Kumar. I'm founder, director, and CFO of Dream Reality Interactive. We focus on virtual reality and augmented reality games, and we are proud to be the tenants here at Faculty West. We are here, around 14 of us. My background in terms of games is over 20 years, mainly Criteria, I was there during burnout and so on. And then I worked quite a lot with streaming, and I can see a few Sony faces here. I also am CEO of Mindwave, which works in healthcare. So we do digital products in healthcare, including augmented reality and virtual reality. I'm actually doing a Vive-based work for in research, mental health research. So it's, again, it's an area where VR and digital technology.
So I'm Ed. I founded Curioscope a couple of years ago. Curioscope's built on the belief that VR and AR is going to transform what we can do with learning, so we can learn about different concepts in a completely different way. Our background, we were very early on the kind of YouTube 360 platform. We've got what is probably the most viewed VR learning experience ever. So it's been watched 30 million times. We've then also got the Virtuality, which is an augmented reality t-shirt that lets you see inside the human body. And we also recently did something with Vive Studios. So whilst we're not a kind of ViveX company, we're probably the other side of the equation, where we've received institutional capital and also Vive Studios money to do individual projects.
Awesome, thank you. So Ed, I'm going to start with you, because we first met a couple of years ago when you were just about to launch the Virtuality. You'd also done this very popular Sharks experience. So you were introducing these individual pieces. What led you to think, actually, now I need to go and raise money? What was your thought process in who you would actually go and approach?
Yeah, I mean, I think from kind of my perspective, we may have and may still be doing kind of like fairly individual products, but we always had a bigger, much grander vision for what Curioscope could be. We always thought that learning would really be transformed by AR and VR, and we still obviously completely believe that. And it just felt like, yes, we could do individual products, but ultimately VR is an early market. It's something that everyone has to encounter, and that perhaps we could raise money to supercharge a bit of the more long-term thinking and move us away from, I think, what a lot of people will be forced into, which is this kind of agency model where ultimately you become whatever project comes your way. We wanted to guide ourselves onto the right projects, onto the right partnerships, rather than just becoming a conglomerate of everything that existed in front of us.
And Kumar, let's talk about dream reality for a minute. So you guys have received external capital, but you've got two parts of the business. You have the studio, but then also kind of underlying tech that you guys are developing. So again, maybe you can just share your experiences of fundraising, who you went to speak to, and what those conversations were like.
So when I set up, there were three of us founders, two ex-Sony and myself, and we very soon started looking for external capital. We needed seed rounds. So we put a deck together and did the usual going around to various people. But actually the company that invested in us found us through Twitter. So social media can work. So we were tweeting all over the place, somebody picked it up, somebody told their boss, and boss liked what we did, we had meetings. And then it took about 6 months to actually go through the paperwork and get the money. So one of the things is,
what was the hashtag you used to raise money?
I must ask Dave. I don't know. Need cash. So what I would say is, being active out there, you need to be visible, you need to be out there so that people can see you as well. But also to have a clear story as to what you want to do. So we had a clear deck that we could go and talk about what we want to do. And as you said, Dave, we had a clear idea. It was certainly in entertainment, that was our sort of primary pillar. Dave had been studio director of Sony London. Richard had been technical director of SingStar for a long time. I had been hanging around games. I'm an accountant, but very well. So we had a good story around the team and the pedigree of the team, which was important for that sort of investor. So it's again picking up those areas as to what you want to do, and we can pick up on those later.
Cool. And so Matt, let's flip it, let's go to the other side of the table. You invested in Gravity Sketch last year and met them earlier later the previous year. So had you been, were you actively looking for investments in this space? And also maybe just for those who don't know Gravity Sketch, maybe you can explain a bit more about what Gravity Sketch do and why you were interested in it.
Yeah, sure. So always get the description of Gravity Sketch wrong, or at least I think the founders like change it on a fairly regular basis, and then tell me if I'm wrong. So I'm not supposed to use the word CAD, but I will. It's CAD in virtual reality. and do you know what? So Forward Partners is not a virtual reality fund, and our investment strategy is to invest in e-commerce, marketplaces, and applied AI, so intelligent software companies, of which Gravity Sketch is not one of either of those three things. But you know, it's important to us to be able to have an open mind and look at these huge new growth areas, or what we assume to be massive growth areas for the future, and to see if there's something interesting going on that we can get the sort of requisite returns out of. And in virtual reality, I mean, it's not super obvious that this is the right time to get in on the consumer side, but what ultimately the virtual reality for CAD enables is that when you're designing anything at all physical and massive, so that's a shoe, that's a car, that's a building, that's a city, whatever it is, the process of product design and drawing it out is so antiquated, it's actually beyond belief how much sketching happens. It's like, you know, those Disney films when you were younger and they showed you the flip book of you know, people sort of Mickey Mouse moving around. It's really not actually that different from that. There's a huge amount of sketching to do with designing a car, which always takes 2-3 more months. And then you go into making things like clay models. It's absolutely nuts. And Gravity Sketch strips out a lot of that complication, because the issue is getting into one-to-one scale from the word go. And if you can do that, you take out a massive amount of complexity from the design process. And so that huge delivery of value is what got me interested. And obviously playing around with VR stuff is also cool.
I can imagine, and I was speaking to one of your colleagues recently, since you invested in Gravity Sketch, because there's not enough VCs investing in VR or AR in Europe, you must have received a lot of pitches, maybe some from people in the audience. So maybe you can highlight things that don't resonate or mistakes that founders make when they come and pitch you as an investor.
Good question.
Without being rude.
So actually, it's one of the things which Ed just mentioned, is this idea of not just building something because there's somebody out there who wants it. And with virtual reality, because it's a nascent technology, on the consumer side, it's a little bit easier because you have more sort of power in that negotiation. With doing enterprise stuff and business stuff, you unlock a pocket of cash from a corporate, and then the temptation is really just to double down on that because virtual reality is not widespread. And so that issue of being not ultimately a virtual reality consultancy, because that could be a great business for you, but it's unlikely to deliver a good return to venture capitalists, is one where I think a lot of people fall down. And then it's this use case first stuff. I mean, I've just been talking about the antiquated process of designing a car, which has literally nothing to do with virtual reality at all. It just happens to be that I think that virtual reality is the solution for that problem. But I was interested in the problem first up, not necessarily that I wanted to make an investment in virtual reality. And those are probably the two idiosyncratic things, that others are slightly more general observations.
So Kumar, your dream reality is very much on the consumer side and in gaming and producing experiences. So maybe you could talk about your experience with Mindwave, which is solving problems in healthcare with AR and VR, amongst other things. Maybe you could talk us through that, and also what the challenge is, because we've just heard that solving problems is great, but selling into healthcare is probably a bit of a minefield. So maybe give us some experience on your B2B side.
Indeed. In terms of healthcare, the selling process and procurement, particularly if you're dealing with NHS, is a total disaster. It's painful. The procurement process can just totally kill you. So it is being very targeted as to where you have the relationships and what sort of projects to go for. In terms of VR and AR, I believe the next few months, at least a year and a half, a lot more will be in either learning and education, so medical and other health education and so on, or research. So one group in Oxford has just been given a seven-figure sum by NIHR, which is the National Institute for Health Research, to look at VR-based solutions for psychosis. So there are quite a bit of research money coming in. So working with people who are looking at either physical health care or mental health care. So we are working on two projects, one with people with brain deficiency through drug taking or brain injury, and another one in addictions. So it's not something that you would immediately think where AR or VR will apply, but there are researchers who are looking to do that, and some of their ideas are really, or they need you to go and really talk to them about what you can do with the technology, and then you marry the two. And there could be some good research funds coming through.
Cool. And Ed, I mean, you're working in education. Education isn't necessarily a space favored by investors, let alone adding education and a new technology on top of it. So it's very, very interesting for us at Vive. So can you maybe give some tips, just some generic tips for the founders in the audience? When you went out to raise that process, we have two great investors on board, Local Globe and Ascension. Any tips for approaching those meetings, things that you've learned you should avoid saying in those meetings, that things that investors want to hear?
Okay. Don't say anything about content, don't say anything about virtual reality, and don't say anything about education. Of which Periscope is definitely all three. Like, I think we made it incredibly difficult for ourselves. I think the important things to know are exactly what Matt's saying, like make sure that you're not just a VR company or you're not just an AR company, make sure you're actually going after something that you can genuinely actually do differently with this technology. You're not just putting X in here, there's actually a real point to doing it. And then my kind of top tip on the fundraising process is that it doesn't happen overnight. And don't expect to just walk into a room with someone and to walk out with a check for money. Our lead investor, Local Globe, were people that I'd known and had spoken to before Curiscope was even called Curiscope, when it was just a very, very vague idea, and I was quickly ushered out of the room for having a very, very vague idea, but ultimately that was something that I could build over time and have a long-term relationship. VR is very new, like we're talking about research funding, like B2B being the important thing. So it's really, really important for everyone to be very aware of that and very aware of where that sits in the venture scale, which is like, we really want you to be a $100 million plus revenue company within this kind of 5 to 10 year time frame. Don't kid yourselves that is not going to be an expectation, and there is not going to be some measure of that happening at some point. And ultimately, for some people, that just may be permanently in conflict with virtual reality as an industry. But I think you'll find there's some people out there who get it and who are willing to go forth on VR becoming something very, very interesting and really disrupting certain things.
And so Matt, coming to you, we've just been talking about $100 million companies, which is really kind of a baseline expectation for whatever it is, 50, 60 million fund forward partners. So when you're getting entrepreneurs through the door, when it comes to 5G, AR, VR, all of that, like, what sort of, have you built a thesis on what other applications or startups you're looking for in this space, or is there any kind of traits that you want to see in those pitches?
Yeah, so 100 million is or an exit potential of 100 million is possibly too low. This is you know, theoretical sort of outcomes, of course. It doesn't necessarily need to be, you need to live that within a year. Just to pick up on one thing which Ed said, and it's about sort of converting investors a little bit, is that so there are some investors out there who are invested in virtual reality, and let's say, for example, those are the ones that get it. But that's, you know, 5%. The other 95% either don't or are waiting to be convinced. And so it's quite powerful for you guys to know your audience, right? So they've worked in virtual reality investing, and so you know that you're talking to someone who kind of understands, but when you talk to me or my colleagues or indeed my peer group, know that 95% of them are there thinking the market's not ready for a big virtual reality outcome. And as a result, that person's probably there thinking about you, that you are a VR enthusiast who wants to make a living out of it. And you need to get that person, you need to get that person back from thinking something along those lines to, I'm a serious lockdown entrepreneur, and I'm using virtual reality to crack a nut like no one else has been able to crack it. So that's the sort of mindset you really want to be taking.
Cool. I have about a million other questions for you guys to tap into expertise. It's very hot and I can see the bar, so I'm wondering maybe if we can go to some questions. If you guys haven't got questions, I have a few more, but let's open it up to the audience. So some questions for these guys from the audience. You need to project. Any brave souls?
Don't be shy.
Oh wow, a very shy audience. Okay, so so Kumar, so tell me about dream reality. You have two different sides of the business, right? You have the studio and then you have building the technology that you have. Maybe for people who are like, oh shit, I'm not building a $1 billion company, what's been your experience of funding in other areas or other sources of funding other than venture?
So one side is we are still doing contracts for hire. So you know, you need to keep the cash flow going, you need to have the staff paid and so on. So we do have contracts going. And of course, if you have a very small team, that can then become very unfocused, and then you really are not being able to keep both going. So one of the things is being very clear as to the focus area. So for us, doing contracts and doing some of those things brings the cash in, I'm able to sort of keep managing the business. But at the same time, from that, we are able to, and from the investor money, able to invest in our technology that we're going to be doing. And that's, if you like, also helps build our story for our next round. So next round could be 2 months to a year and a half. So we are aiming for that round and looking to see as to how we can construct that story. And much of that will fall into the same things that Matt and Ed have been saying. We don't want to go and say, you know, the fact that we came from games and we were focused on entertainment a year ago for seed funds were fine, but now it's not. You know, you can't just go and say, that's what we are doing, we can do great stuff in VR. We need that clear story, and that's where we are going next.
I would say one kind of tip for myself is, I think when you're a VR founder, like thinking about the amount of money that you're raising, because of like the market timing and the market uncertainty, it's one scenario where you might actually encourage a founder to take slightly more dilution or take slightly more money off the table, because your investor is going to want to know that, you know, if, you know, like whatever the market timing, whether you're selling to enterprise and you've got a long sales cycle, or as consumer and you're waiting for kind of mass adoption of headsets, you know, to have that extra kind of buffer, you know, in software, you might only raise 9 to 12 months cash. In VR, you might be raising more like 12 to 24 months cash, but you need to come with the story of how you're actually going to okay, has anyone thought of a question?
Just a good one for me, because a lot of the stuff I'm seeing as well is, you look at, obviously, investors looking for scalability, right? Platform is a big thing, and scalability drives revenues, which drives returns. E-commerce seems to be an interesting area, just in terms of what you look for at strategics, so big corporates, big, big, it can actually be, you know, pure online players like Made.com as well, but also, you know, the IKEAs of the world, where you're starting to see these kinds.
I really want to get a question from, yes, we have one.
A question from Matt. How deep is your involvement in that particular startup? Are you there on a weekly basis or a monthly basis? Are you attending certain meetings? Are you busy in the design process, thinking with them? What the approach is?
So good question. Just for everyone who might not have heard that, it was a question about how involved day-to-day I am with Gravity Sketch. And the short answer is not much. Venture capitalists invest in founders because, first and foremost, because we believe in their ability to grow and build a great business, right? We're there more or less for consultancy. Fortunately, at Forward Partners, like I mentioned, we have the product growth and tech team, so we're actually running a hiring. We've got a head of talent, so we're running a hiring process for them mm-hmm. at the moment, but I'm not involved in that. So, you know, the cadence of, like, board meetings once every couple of months, I meet up with the guys for drinks because I like them, and we shoot the breeze about VR, work problems, whatever it is. But ultimately, I'm there on the end of WhatsApp every single day, so...
Is that a typical style of your company? Because I can imagine there are also investment companies who really deliver the knowledge of daily management, advice.
So I'm not an employee of the company. I'm an investor.
Yourself, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So what you're outlining is a slightly more sort of day-to-day business as usual
advisory
relationship,
yeah.
Which, you know, I'm a board member, not an employee or a consultant.
Of course, yeah.
I would just add to that. I think when you're out fundraising, I mean, first of all, you kind of, you know, to get any money is good. You know, sometimes you don't have any choice. But if you're out there with a good business, you should be confident that any investor will invest in you. You know, qualify them first. You don't take too long. Once you know who the interested investors are, you do need to know a bit about them. Like, do your research just as they're doing research on you. So, you know, for example, it might be that you have a lead investor like Matt, you know, who has, you know, great, you know, funds to do follow-on, you know, great kind of, you know, links into big organizations, whatever it happens to be. There might be certain things they do or don't like help with. But then you might have someone like ViveX where, you know, we're going to be more active because we have the thing. So, and it's up to the founder to choose the mix of, you know, who you want on your cap table. It's probably, I would say, in this area, to have somebody who is, you know, whether it's an angel who's putting in 50K, but, you know, they're in high up in the product team in, you know, X company, or, you know, somebody who's got 20 years of gaming background and knows 20 developers. Like, think about those, that value adds you want, and don't just think about finding one investor, think about a group of investors. Okay, Bertie had a question just down there. He even messaged me to tell me.
Well, for clarification, I'm right behind his laptop in his field of view, so otherwise I don't think he can see me. Okay, so it's a two-part question, really. So first part of the question is for Kumar and Ed, and that's, how do you figure out how much money to raise? And the question for Matt and for Dave is, how do you figure out how much you're willing to invest? Because obviously an investor doesn't just go, I will invest 100% of what you want into the company. So how do you guys, like, do those equations?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of VCs say it's an art, not a science. There is obviously you need to, like, work out what you need to spend, you need to roughly project out the future, but ultimately there is a lot of things that are going to change over the next period of time. So I think ultimately you just need to make sure that probably in your kind of normal to worst case scenarios, you're okay to X period of time. Now, if you're just doing something like 5X, that's probably going to be like a 6 month to 12 month timeline. If you're wanting to raise a bit more, that might be an 18 to 24 month timeline. And I definitely think, echoing the point, that in VR that probably should be longer. Like, you should be looking to go as far as possible because it's not moving and it's not expanding as quickly as possible. And then I think ultimately there is just a pre-seed round or an angel round looks like an angel round, a seed round looks like a seed round. And ultimately there are certain investors who do certain rounds, and those investors will have their sweet spot, they'll have what they're willing to go for, and yeah, if that's somewhat useful.
Speaking up on that, first of all, to have your mind clear as to what your business plan is. So there has to be a business plan. I know it will change month by month, other priorities will come in, but you're starting something to be clear as to what your costs are, whether it's for 6 months or 1 year, just get something down so that you have some idea and focus. Then, in terms of how it happened with us was, yeah, how much we were willing to give away and how much the investor was willing to put in, and that combination, of course, basically comes up with evaluation. And since it was three of us and a keynote presentation, and that was it, it was an interesting conversation, and we did manage to come to a number based on that. So we agreed a percentage that we gave away and how much they were willing to put in. But so when we had the term sheet and agreed the investment, we really hadn't really started the search. We had put some code together, but there was hardly anything there. But once we went in and got that investment tied up, then we went on to a CIS, EIS platform, and there are many of those, and go on to that. And that would be counted as part of the seed round. And what I would say is, if you're looking at that, do get yourself pre-qualified with HMRC so that investors know that you are covered and get the paperwork done. And which of course means that there are quite a few groups out there where you can go to and get your CIS, EIS top-up funding. So you can raise 150 to 250 or 300K.
So you might get more than 100% of what you want. So in that sketch's case, the initial round size which the guys were thinking about was actually less than half of what it ended up being. And it's precisely because of this reason of wanting to buy more time for the company, because it's involved in enterprise sales cycles, which could be 3 months, 6 months, 24 months. We know more now than we did then. But no, it's we want to capitalize companies to give them the greatest chance of success. And then looping back to what these guys said, we want you to have proper assumptions to tell us not only what the scale of your ambition is, but how you're going to get there. So what the amount of money that you want to raise needs to be tightly linked to what you're going to do in the months coming, who you're going to hire, what do you think the cost of sales are going to be, or the acquisition costs are going to be, and all this kind of stuff. And the more real world information you can put into those business plans, the less valuation becomes an art and it becomes a science, because that's defensible, right? Because you are raising a certain amount, because that amount of money is going to buy you 18 months. In 8 months' time, you can be there and you can be raising this much at that valuation. Okay, great. So working back from there, we need $1 million in order to do that, and investment rounds are roughly 20%.
Yeah, I would just add and say two things. I think one in Europe, well, first of all, you should, again, this is about qualifying your investor. Before you go into a meeting, before you spend too much time, ask the investor, what is your typical check size? Like, do you like to lead? I see a lot of founders who have small commitments, but they still need to get that lead. So you need to understand those people. And most VCs blog, most of them tweet, you can reach them on social media. So, it's your bag if you haven't done your research, and that should guide a lot of your thinking. And it might differ if you meet one investor and they know they're doing something, you need to have the mental agility to flip between a few different scenarios. The other thing I'd say, which is really confusing for European founders, is if you read a VR Focus or a TechCrunch, there's a lot of kind of fanfare when companies raise their rounds. You'll see a lot of US companies raising money. Now, the investment environment here is very different to in the US, and then very different again to Asia. So in the US, typically early rounds need less qualification. They're probably slightly higher. They're going to be raising on a note versus evaluation. At Seedcamp, we invested in a US company called Wave VR. I invested in the seed round. They didn't even have the product. I actually tried it out with Graham at the Vive office. The prototype was upside down. I was literally upside down in the virtual DJ booth. They were raising $2.5 million, and they were massively oversubscribed. So don't kind of either just move to San Francisco and go and raise my colleagues out there, or if you're in Europe, you need to kind of temper and kind of figure out where you are vis-a-vis the appetite and the climate here. Cool. I'm going to take one more question, because it's quite hot in here, and then we'll all be around. I think most of you guys will kind of hang around. So let's have one last question for this chap in the front.
Hi. The last thing you say is something I wanted to ask. Why is the focus on European investment different from the US or the Asian? In terms, for example, you're probably here much more on the B2B. It's something that is required by the investment community, or it's something actually you think is more feasible to the geography or projects that are being inside the region?
Yeah, good question. And you mean related to ViveX, not
exactly
investment? Yeah, so I mean, we're open to any business. So you know, if you're not doing B2B enterprise, you know, we're still applying. You know, we're still looking to. I think what's interesting. I mean, first of all, you know, Vive is very well placed to help you in the B2B enterprise. You know, large organizations, whether it's Airbus or whether it's Boeing or whether it's Volkswagen, they're all adopting VR and they're all looking for solutions. Like someone like Volkswagen has identified that 16 different points in their business where VR is a game changer. So. You know, we've done a lot of work to establish ourselves as a leader in that space. I also think just historically, there is a lot of talent. I went to Laval Virtual the other week, and you know, there's companies that have been doing enterprise VR for like 10 plus years, you know, whether it's in CAD or visualization. So there is just a lot of talent here, and I think you need, you know, as Europe, you know, you play to your strengths, and that, you know, we think enterprise and B2B is where we expect to find great deals. Obviously, if we don't, then we'll, you know, I'm looking at, you know, a range of different technologies and sectors. But does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Good stuff. So I just have is Kieran here yet? Oh, okay. Well, I'm just going to say it myself because Kieran isn't here to do the quick advert. Thank you again to Huckletree as our host. This is an awesome working space. There's a number of companies like Dream Reality Interactive. You'll see it later on, but we also have our the Vive VR lab right out in the back with a couple of pros in it. So, you know, if you are a company and you're looking for space, then definitely go. Oh, Kieran, do you want to quickly say hi and do a quick minute plug?
I'm like so on the
pad. Okay, I think I've just done the plug for you. So,
if anybody wants to like come towards me afterwards, we're an amazing co-working space. So if you want to have a tour around or just want to chat with me, I'll be like over there.
Well, one of the things, there is actually two, you might say, there are a couple of Vive Pros set up.
Beat Saber.
So if you're not catching up already, it's really hot in there. And when you mentioned before, have a focus. If you haven't tried it, you want to have a look.
So yeah, so let's end with a massive round of applause for our panelists.
Thank you.